a very good question, and I think it's somewhat misunderstood and really misdiagnosed many times. DIPNECH is an acronym, so it stands for Diffuse Idiopathic Pulmonary Neuroendocrine Cell Hyperplasia. So it's a mouthful, so that's why we call it DIPNECH. So the cells of the, or the tubes of the lung are lined with neuroendocrine cells, and what DIPNECH is when these cells enlarge, and this can cause various symptoms that I'll talk about. What can happen is patients with this type of condition they get misdiagnosed many times because they have chronic respiratory problems. So things like cough or wheeze or shortness of breath. In many cases, they're associated with these carcinoid tumors. The thought is that this can be a pre-malignant condition. So we see a lot of times patients with a known carcinoid tumor, they'll have some characteristic findings either on their CT scan, or we actually see this. The best way to really diagnose this, or the only way to really diagnose is this through underneath the microscope, where we see these classic findings. So it tends to affect women more so than men. We see this sort of in the diagnosed more in the middle ages. Patients again can suffer from cough for a very long time. That's one of the most frequent symptoms I see. You know, they get diagnosed with asthma or COPD. Some of the breathing tests that we do can show findings consistent with obstructive symptoms. So this is why we say, all right, well, you know, patients have asthma or COPD, but they actually don't have this. They have this thing called DIPNECH. So it's rare. You know, and that's why, you know, a lot of folks, you know, don't really think about this. So DIPNECH is primarily associated with respiratory symptoms. So cough, wheeze, shortness of breath, and these can be chronic in nature. Esophageal spasms, reflux, probably not so much associated with DIPNECH, but certainly reflux is one of the most common causes of cough as well. I don't see an association, a direct association between it, but certainly reflux can make some of these symptoms worse. So the standard of care is a biopsy. And a lot of times it needs to be more than just a needle biopsy. It needs to be an actual open biopsy confirmed by a pathologist who really knows what to look for. Now there's some findings on CT that you could look at and say, all right, well, if these findings on CT in conjunction with some of the symptoms that you're experiencing, that may be enough to say, all right, well, this is consistent with DIPNECH and maybe we should talk about some treatment. So hypoxia is simply a decreased amount of oxygen in the blood. And it can be secondary to many different things. So including DIPNECH, including pulmonary edema. So some of it depends on what, you know, why is the patient hypoxic in getting to the underlying cause of that. So since we're talking about DIPNECH and lung carcinoid, I'm assuming that's, you know, that would be the cause of the hypoxia. Mm-hmm. So figuring out, all right, is this a tumor blocking an airway? Is this something that we need to go in with a bronchoscope and open up that airway? Is this something that needs to be surgically resected? If this is DIPNECH, does my patient need to be on a somatostatin analog, which we've seen can show some benefits? We don't see much in the way of, you know, pulmonary edema, in some of the neuroendocrine patients. So that a lot of times that is caused, that's caused from other issues, primarily the heart. So really it's getting to the underlying cause and correcting that. That's a conversation for the transplant team. There's not everybody's going to do this. Not everybody's going to be familiar with it. But I would think somebody who is starting out with very, very low lung function would probably go to the top of the list as far as getting a transplant, you know, whether it's DIPNECH or other types of chronic lung diseases. So the big thing, you know, with any of the transplants is patients with cancer, you know, sort of, you know, get frowned upon, you know, when it comes to transplant. So you've got to be at a center that is familiar with this and don't be afraid to look for another opinion, you know, just because you get turned down from one center, look around and say, all right, well, this center doesn't do this. And so maybe somewhere else will. As far as I know, at our own center, we haven't transplanted anybody with DIPNECH. But I've certainly heard of other centers doing this, you know, and it's in the literature for those patients with severe symptoms. I think it's certainly a viable treatment option, but again, you got to be careful. You're trading one thing for another. Certainly the big thing, I want everyone to take home is with this type of cancer, with this, you know, with these types of rare diseases, you really need to be taken care of by someone who is familiar with this. So a specialty center who has a multidisciplinary team. It's really, really important. So formal guidelines, there's not. It's a rare disease. So we were actually just talking about this at our national meeting. There's not even a registry looking at this. And that's one of the ways that we come up with guidelines to say, all right, well, you know, how many patients have this in the country worldwide? And that's really, it's not even known just yet. So it's something that we need to do, but unfortunately we don't have it yet. So the biggest thing that I look for when I follow a patient is how are they feeling? That's the number one thing I look for. And I can get scans and I can get markers and different kind of things. But sometimes they're not always exact. In someone with DIPNECH, I can look at certain types of markers and they may not even correlate, you know, with what my patient is feeling like or what symptoms they're experiencing. So a lot of times really for DIPNECH, there's no real validated markers. So, I mean, we talk about markers. Chromogranin is one of the ones that gets tossed out a lot. This is something that can go up and down depending on medications and other factors. So it's something that maybe may not be the most reliable. There's other types of markers that are similar that can kind of vary. And we certainly follow this more with some of the GI neuroendocrine tumors. But yeah, if I've got a patient and I happen to get a 5-HIA on this patient and it's elevated at the time of their cancer diagnosis and we take the cancer out, I would expect that marker to drop. If it starts rising again, and I say, all right, well, maybe things are advancing. For DIPNECH, we don't really have very good markers. So I tend to follow more with what are the scans looking like and what's my patient looking like. A while there's certainly a genetic component, or there can be a genetic component to neuroendocrine tumors in the lung, we don't see it a whole lot, but nonetheless, we can certainly see this run in families or in patients who have multiple primary tumors. So for instance, a primary pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, and then also a primary neuroendocrine tumor of the lung. We see that, again, uncommon. I don't know of any genetic or familial DIPNECH syndromes. So very good question. And, you know, there's a suggestion that, you know, all right, so what came first? You have this carcinoid tumor and it's surrounded by DIPNECH. Well, it must have turned, that DIPNECH must have turned into this carcinoid cancer. Or does this do this? There's no real literature to say, yes, you have X number of years before this will turn into cancer. I mean, patients can have this for many, many years. Like I said, you know, they get misdiagnosed, and I've had patients, oh, I've coughed for 20 years and now finally I have something. So, or I have a reason for that cough. So there's no real, you know, data to say, all right, well, you know, the median number of years is X before you get a carcinoid tumor. Yeah, I think that's where patients a lot of times get started. You know, again, they see the pulmonary doc, and most of the patients I've seen with DIPNECH, they've been through courses of steroids, different inhalers, this and that. They've sort of gone through the whole gamut here. And then every now and again, the pulmonary doc will say, wait, what about DIPNECH here? You know, and then they get referred over to me. I think, you know, co-management of things. And if an inhaler is good enough to control symptoms, maybe I can avoid anything else. But sometimes, you know, we need that multidisciplinary approach to care. So lung neuroendocrine tumors can certainly produce a variety of hormones, including histamine. Produce ACTH as well. This produces the carcinoid syndrome. But it's uncommon for these things to produce these types of hormones. I mean, we certainly see it and we watch out for it. But I think if we recognize that hormonal release syndrome, well, then we treat it as a functional tumor. And hopefully with definitive treatment, we take that tumor out, that functional tumor goes away. So I've got patients who have an ACTH secreting tumor, for instance, and they develop Cushing's syndrome. And so we take that tumor out, their symptoms go away, but that ACTH is something that we can monitor from here on out. We see it starting to go up. We say, all right, well, maybe we need to scan earlier or figure out, you know, what else is happening here.